We're still getting settled in, but I don't want to waste a moment's time. I want you to be able to hear all of Tom Kerns and have time for questions and answers. Let's dedicate our time to God this day with a word of prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, today officially begins our year of celebration of a sure foundation. And there are at least three meanings for that term, sure foundation. Of course, the first is that this parish is founded on the sure foundation that is Christ Jesus, our Lord. It is God who has brought us through the past, guiding us today, and gives us hope for the future. It is the 200th anniversary of the laying of the cornerstone of our Latrobe Treasure Church. And so we'll be celebrating that, and that's the topic of our conversation today. And the third is to highlight the work of our own St. Paul's Foundation and the important mission that they do and on our behalf. And I want to introduce our new president, John Siegel, who has a word from the foundation, and then I'll introduce our speaker for today. Welcome, John.
So thank you all very much for having us up here this morning, and it's a pleasure to see you, and it's a real pleasure to serve as president of the foundation. I'll give you just a quick word on the foundation before we get into the lecture. The foundation was founded in 1992 and has really grown through the generosity of the parishioners to over 3.5 million over that period of time. So we have a good quantum of capital that we're overseeing now. It was started with the primary goal to preserve and then build upon the church that we have here. So we really focus on the elements of the church, the building, HVAC, the roof, and other elements, physical elements of the church. So over the past few years, we've been, I think, a big driver in both capital campaigns, been really cornerstones to the capital campaigns. In terms of the physical things that we've done around the church, in the past 10 years, we've actually been paying the mortgage. We've contributed a bunch to the windows, so all the stained glass that you've seen that's come in and come out. And then over the next, now that the mortgage is retired, we'll be putting a bunch of money into a sinking fund to go towards the HVAC. So I know you guys did not come to church this morning to hear us talk about HVACs and mortgages and stained glass windows, but just a quick commercial on why the foundation is important. Because by raising money and focusing on those issues, what we actually do is we free up the annual operating budget of the church to go towards the bigger mission of this community. So rather than having your annual contributions to the church go towards a new roof or fixing a bad window or HVAC, if the foundation is able to take care of that, it frees up that money to go towards other elements of the community, which is really part of the mission of the church. So that's kind of the long-term mission of where we're trying to go to with the foundation. The foundation, one of the big drivers of the foundation, how we've grown the corpus, is through the covenant circle, which is people who are looking, as they're doing estate planning, to consider St. Paul's in their foundation, the foundation in their estate planning. So I'm happy to talk to anyone about that after the meeting. Mariah Halloran is around here somewhere over there. You can grab Mariah, or there's plenty of information on the website, but I'll get out of no more mortgages, stained glass windows, or any of that type of stuff, and we'll get on to the lecture, so thank you very much.
I introduce someone to you today who needs no introduction, a friend of St. Paul's, an honorary member of St. Paul's, a gifted architect, a man of deep faith. I think his time among us has only deepened and strengthened his connection to our architect, Benjamin Latrobe, and he's become somewhat of an expert, and we're glad to welcome you, Tom Kerns. Welcome.
Thank you. Well, it's great to be with you. I want to talk a little bit about Latrobe and also what a treasure that this place is. First about Latrobe. Benjamin Latrobe was born in 1764 in England, and he was raised by Moravian parents who believed in education, and they sent him to Germany to study. He became fluent in German, French, knew some Italian. He's 6 foot two, he's good looking, and really a great professional. And then he decided to become an architect, and he studied in England under Sir John Soane. And he believed that, based on his training, that architecture was a profession. It wasn't, a craft. It was a true profession. And he became really, in America, the first professional architect. He believed that you should hire an architect for his design talent, for his drawings, for his ability to supervise construction, and that he should be paid a fair wage. And in his day, he said 5% of the cost of construction was his fee. And so he set that down, you know, that you should be paid a fair wage or a fair fee for your talent. And before Latrobe came to America, design was created by skilled brickmakers, masons, carpenters. If St. Paul's would be built maybe 30 years earlier, a mason would be contracted to say, well, just make it 4 foot larger than Culpeper. And that's all they needed. That's all they needed, and that's what they did. But Latrobe felt that there was more to see, and being a worldly person, he came to America in somewhat of a tough spot. His life was like a roller coaster. He married very early. By his mid-20s, he was married. He had one child right after, 2 years after we were married. He had his second child the next year, and the next year his wife dies of childbirth. So he started his family young, but the death of his wife sent him into a spiral of depression, and it took him a long time to recover, and he finally said, I need a change of venue. I just got to get out of England. And so he came to America. He came to America then, at around the age of 30. So his studies included the former masters here of Palladio, and I want to just call your attention here to the simplicity. You can see a square, you can see the circle in the square. Palladio was a man of proportion. They studied the golden ratio, which occurs throughout nature. This is part of his education. He studied buildings like the Parthenon, and many of you know that the Parthenon is a golden proportion, and we've had lots of professors look at this and study these proportions, and he definitely knew that. Before he came to America, he worked for an architect in London, and he was able to do several large houses. But again, his family life required him to leave. And when he came to America, he was also a very gifted artist. He kept a beautiful series of sketchbooks, and he would often do watercolors and pen and ink sketches, such as this. And this is an example of another one of his sketches, and he came to Virginia very early. Architect of Bruton Parish. Many of you have been to Williamsburg and have seen Bruton Parish. He quickly became part of the society, and it was well known with politicians and leaders of the early states. Again, an example of his study of Palladio and this idea of an organization of a square, and if you can introduce a round space within the square, all the better, because if it was good enough for the Renaissance, it's good enough for a basis in which to develop our new nation. He did do some domestic architecture, and this is one of the few books that are written about his domestic work. One of the important houses that he did do is the Decatur House on Lafayette Park. Again, just another study of his work. He was a beautiful draftsman. He was an engineer. He understood how buildings should be supported. He understood the importance of ventilation and tried to incorporate all those into this sort of dome structure. He also designed furniture. He worked on the White House and the Capitol, and he designed furniture. He was an extremely gifted artist and interested in furniture. And I was struck just a couple of nights ago, Brian Williams had this Life of Obama, and there was this photograph, this opening photograph of Obama looking south out of the Oval Office toward the Washington Monument. And in that bay window is a Latrobe settee, a bench, with that sort of same sort of Egyptian scroll work. And it's probably an original. So again, just the study of proportions and colors, bringing the sense of the history of England. Here's the Decatur House, searching for that geometry and searching for that that use of the circle. More sketchbook information, travels. So now we'll start studying about his architecture. He moved to Baltimore. He came to Baltimore and actually remarried in Baltimore. But one of his first commissions was by Bishop Carroll to design a new cathedral in Baltimore. And he struggled with the design, and he felt that it would be appropriate that a cathedral could be of the Gothic style. And so he prepared a design based on the Gothic style. And when he came from England, he brought a 1,500 volume library with him. So, I mean, he had his books. And so he studied the Gothic style and presented that to Bishop Carroll. And Bishop Carroll really had problems with the depth of the space and didn't care for it at all, and told Latrobe to start over, basically. So Latrobe started over and looked again at his roots of Italian Renaissance and Romanesque kind of structure, and he prepared a Romanesque design, which Bishop Carroll approved. And you can see the sort of the engineer in him in the brick vaulting of the basement to support the structure above. He used that same technique at the Capitol, and his initial budget for the cathedral was $60,000. I'm not sure what the final cost was, but that, just as a rule of thumb, let's just say it's $100,000. You know, we're talking 1810. Anyway, it was built in. For those of you who have not seen it, I really recommend that you go there, because it's been completely restored about 10 years ago. Basically, since Bishop Carroll, every bishop that has come after him has darkened the space. You know, they put in stained glass windows. They painted Victorian dark green colors. And so the restoration is basically to restore it back to Latrobe, which is a very white container. And the color of the space is the assembly. And so here it is restored. It's restored today at the dedication. It's well worth the trip. Pohick Church is an example of before Latrobe came, again, 4 feet larger than Culpeper. You know, that's sort of the idea. And it's a fine building, but it doesn't have the background that Latrobe wanted us to do. So as you know, Dr. Wilmer was the rector here, as well as the rector at St. John's, Lafayette Park. And he knew of Latrobe and asked Latrobe to design this church in the early 1800s. And he prepared a Gothic church, a Gothic design. It's one of the really few Gothic buildings that remain in Latrobe's hand. And he He had some inspiration. He was looking at, again, through his travels and his education. He knew of the Gothic style. He knew of the parterre of three. He knew of the parterre of three Gothic tall pieces. And so that's what he proposed for this church, for this building. And Dr. Wilmer and the vestry approved the design. And here you can see my drawing of the original church. And guess what it is? It's a square. It's a square with a very slender narthex that we still have today and an extremely small chancel. But here we are, simplicity at its best. And here we are studying the golden proportion. So the drawings were given to the parish. Let me see what I got here. Yeah, there's the golden section. Drawings were given to the parish, and they retained a really good builder, Mr. Bosworth. Mr. Bosworth started construction, talking to the vestry, talking to Dr. Wilmer. They decided to make some changes. And Latrobe was not hired to really be active during construction, but he happened to come by, and he noticed that the church was 18 inches short. 18 inches short, which was a big deal if you're studying the golden proportion, if you'd be off by that much. I mean, this is serious. And then he went around the side. He shouldn't have gone around the side. Because the vestry and Dr. Wilmer changed his Gothic windows to square. And to quote him, he said, "A confession of ostentatious poverty." You had the good sense to build the front right. But for God's sakes, how did you go to square? And the good thing is he didn't come in because you added a balcony. Oh. So thank you very much, Mr. Latrobe. And you know, now we need to build, you know, what we need to do. And so we added a balcony. And there are several letters in your history books here about the parish between Latrobe and Wilmer. And it was, I mean, they really hit each other pretty hard about it. But it just shows his dedication to the profession and his desire to get it right and his desire to instill the profession of architecture here to good clients like St. Paul's. And then, so that's like 1812, 1816. And then in 1906, you add the chancel up front, and that grows out up front. And so the plan becomes extended, and this is typical in the life of churches and buildings that they evolve and they grow. And so in 06, you add the chancel, and Smoot Lumber Company builds that reredos of walnut, and that sort of forms a backdrop to the table. So now we have a dark backdrop against what previously was a white sort of container to add focus up front. There's the reredos in 06. And then the balcony, as I mentioned, was a parish add. And this is before, obviously, you know, the beautiful organ that you've added. There you go. So. And these are furnishings, I believe, that were added in 06. And then the cross is much later. So I don't know the date, but I'm sure some of you here were present when that cross was built. I believe it was the time of the chapel. Oh. Okay. So that's sort of the early life of the church, obviously before we, but I think it sets the place in history of this church. Now, this is a sketch of Jefferson. This is Latrobe's sketch of Jefferson. And Jefferson had appointed him as the surveyor of all federal buildings. He built, Latrobe was in charge of the south wing of the Capitol, White House. I mean, he was a busy guy while he was doing St. John's and this church. But Latrobe had Jefferson's confidence as a talented designer. And so Latrobe, well, Jefferson asked two people for a crypt of the university that he was building in Virginia, in Charlottesville. He asked Latrobe for a crypt, and he asked another architect named William Thornton for a crypt. Thornton was more of an engineer, and he and Latrobe never saw eye to eye. Just totally two different, totally two different people. So Latrobe, Jefferson writes the letter, Thornton replies with the exact questions that Thornton, that Jefferson asked for, you know, three questions, three answers. Engineering kind of answers. Latrobe writes back and says, your entire plan lacks any focus. There's no organization to it. What it needs to have something at the end, and it needs to be terraced. Jefferson gets the letter, and the rest is history. We have the rotunda, and we have the terracing. And Jefferson's definition of originality is one's ability to conceal your source. So Jefferson knew who to ask. Jefferson knew who to ask, and he took it, and he ran with it. But that's true. So here's Latrobe's studies of various pavilions as they step down the hill. Here's the idea of the rotunda with the perfect circle. And here we are, you know, a few years ago. And then here's one of my little sketches of Pavilion 9, where there's just great spill of natural light over the door, and the door is protected by the architecture of the rain. It's just a beautiful use of volume. And there's another Pavilion 10. So, I mean, basically, we step down this terraced lawn. So now we have the National Trust here. This is a historic place, and it's been my privilege and honor to work with you over the last few years. But many good architects have preceded my work. David Rosenthal was a very good architect here in Alexandria, and he did a fine addition of a small little weekday chapel, which Latrobe didn't do. It wasn't in Wilmer's brief, but I think it's a great ingredient. It just shows the example of how churches evolve and the needs of various ages and congregations evolve. But, you know, it's bathed in this beautiful light. And again, I really like it. So about 10 years ago or more, we were asked to improve Wilmer Hall and to sort of look at the entire campus. And Maury chaired the committee. And so here's the Duke Street elevation, changing and rethinking Wilmer. And there was this slot between Wilmer and the first house there. And that slot was just wide enough to put in a stair and an elevator, which we were able to do. And I think of it as sort of a hyphen, dark hyphen. And the BAR liked it too. And then the railing sort of, you know, like Latrobe, we sort of looked for the finer grain in architecture to try to elevate and signify the purpose to buildings. And the Episcopal shield is who we are, it's part of our identity. And if there's a way to to announce that subtly to the community, all the better. And so I think that's a fine way to integrate art and functionality into a building. And it's also accessible, and that was a part of the program, is to make this building as accessible as possible. And so here's a quick little sketch, sort of an initial sketch of that shield in the railing. Now the next challenge we had was like 2007, 2006. Well, we had a major maintenance problem, and many junior wardens here suffered through the garth. It was a water trap, and it had been filled in. And basically, what had happened in '55, a local architect, Mr. Smith, added this hall that we're in, and provide this sort of 8-foot wide gap. But it was a maintenance headache. And fortunately, at the end, there was this opening that had been bricked up. Let me see if I can go back. You see at the end there, you can see that brick was filled in. So that was the first clue that we could open this back up to Pitt Street, or at least see Pitt Street. So we opened it back up, and then we thought we wanted to enclose it to get rid of the water and the snow and the maintenance issue. And there were other people that knew Latrobe had designed this church, like the city. and there was a society called the Latrobe Society. That was sacred fabric. This wall, right out here, sacred fabric. Even though in 1925 it had been coated with like an inch of stucco. Anyway, sacred fabric. And so there was a Saturday at the city council, probably many of you went, where we finally got approval to put a glass roof over the garth only if we could remove it. So working with Duncan, the city struck a covenant where we can remove the glass roof in case some future vestry decides to make it exterior space again. So there are a lot of folks that are looking at this, you know, beautiful building and wall and trying to. So we studied it. We, you know, studied it here in the office in model form, and these windows and this idea of these, you know, sort of communicating windows is great. And, you know, so here's the glass roof, and it's bolted to the wall with like 20 some screws that can all be taken apart. And so today it's a great way to enter, you know, worship without steps, from worship without steps. Choir cues up, lots of good use for it. And one of the reasons I like it is that it's a contrast of our time, that it's clearly not Latrobe, it's not of Norton Hall Smith, but it's of our day. And it's sort of a little history book. It's a history book of your beautifully restored stained glass windows. I like the light. It's north light. It's artist's light. It rarely gets direct light. Again, these beautiful windows, and part of me as an artist wants to come back and capture that light. Latrobe built on Bosworth built, like Latrobe asked, on solid rock foundations. So part of the history book are the foundations upon which Latrobe's building rests. Huge, huge rocks. Those crosses were part of the facade early 1900s. They were removed when the stuccoing was redone, I think in 2025. And today are part of the history and beautifully shown in this north light right outside. Let's now just talk a couple of smaller projects that we've worked on since that major project of doing the garth. And as Maury likes to say, we did it before the crash. That was great. The timing was perfect. Okay, so Norton Hall's door and today's new door was part of a project called Cheeseman Cloister. And that was a great small project, again, requiring BAR approval. And we basically wanted to improve the safety for the children, accessibility from here to the playground, and to, again, provide some safety. And you know, the playground. So we secured the playground. We did new paving and railings in the work. And that was all, you know, including the Norton door, but, you know, sort of, again, the attention to detail. How can you work with the gates and make them part of this place? And then Judith calls and says, we need a cover. So could you do a watercolor? Sure. And then the last project, which I really want to compliment the foundation and the entire congregation on, is the complete long-term restoration of the facades. They really needed it, and it's just terrific that you did it. The facade was failing, you know, collected grime and dirt, and it just really needed to be totally replaced. And one of the issues was the absorbing of water. It was sort of like a wick. It was just wicking up. And so we studied Latrobe's drawings and that early photo of Bonds. And Latrobe actually had a stone foundation. I don't know what the point is. Oh, sugar. Back up. All right. Anyway, there was a red base, like a base, all the way around, red stone, and then stucco. So we've reintroduced, and there's a sample there, we've reintroduced the red base, and it's a hard stone. And so we've waterproofed it, and then we put the red stone back. And so the wicking now, you can't wick through the hard stone. You know, the straw has been stopped 6 inches short of the water. And with today's technology and waterproofing, you know, we really have developed a long-term permanent answer to that issue. And it was all done. Ann was the chairman of the committee this summer. We stayed in business. We had a terrific builder who was very aware of the building, aware of the public. And like when they were cleaning or sandblasting or doing grit, cutting bricks, he had a hose out there, and he offered free car washes to anybody that got brick on their car. It was really a great relationship. Really, really good guy. So here we are setting the new stones. We told the city it's a repair project. Every time on my drawings I could say the word repair, I did. That was, and they signed off as a repair project. So that was good. We put weed killer in the sand. So those bricks are going to, weeds going to have a hard time as soon as they get down to the sand bed. They're not going to like it. And then we looked at the lighting and the paint colors of the narthex and sort of return that back to what Latrobe would have, I think, liked. It would have been of the period. You know, his would have been gas, but anyway, we were able to restore the narthex. And today it's a long-term contribution to the town, and it's dead on the money in terms of straightness. It'll stay straight. The paving is forgiving and is just good for a long time. And I really just am so glad that you did it. So this will forever be part of the architectural story of the building and of the city. The city is proud of it. We're all just proud that you've restored it. So just one last little slice. So it's truly been an honor to work here, and you know, again, I want to thank the foundation for all the good work that you've done over time. Thank you. Okay. First question, when was the stucco installed? It was installed around 1925. It's 1 inch thick. It is super dense, super hard. It was provided by a man named Early. And that material was used throughout the city and in, I'm trying to think of the park that goes up in DC. But anyway, 1925. The question of the lighthouses at the end, they were provided in 1955 by a local architect named William Smith. I think they were trying to flex themselves as dependencies to the Gothic style, to the Gothic building, sort of bridging your way to this space, to this building. And he was trying to, you know, lengthen Latrobe by adding these dependencies. That's, yes. I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Or anything. We've considered that. Yeah, I mean, again, it's a question of how authentic do you want to stay to Latrobe and add the conveniences that we are today. But we considered this. It's not an easy challenge. You have to lose some interior volume to get up there. You know, we can't go out. Right.
And can I go back to Tim?
You can, sure.
You were most kind. I know that you're not a friend of the watchtowers. You didn't say anything. And I will never forget your very first design for us, your first imagining of restoring was like the Baltimore Cathedral.
Right.
And that Tom's design was to release the building from all those dependencies. So we didn't go that direction, but I remember that was your original thought.
Even to the degree of taking the vestry room off.
Yeah.
Restore as much as you can.
You said that the front of the church, I'm glad that photo's up there, you said the front of the church was shaped like the golden rectangle, but it was 18 inches too
short.
So, is it still?
No.
They fixed it?
No. You built it 18 inches too short. Oh. So the proportion's not right.
Oh.
And that's the reason for the letter.
Yeah.
Grilling Wilmer. Yeah.
And the idea was that he wanted those arches on the ground floor, just like arches at the top of those windows, with the arched on both. So now they just go straight up the first floor and then arch at the top.
He even told Wilmer, you just saved $347. I mean, he figured out what. Why did I do my drawings? Why did I do my drawings?
We forget about these folks seem so serious, but having such a good sense of humor. The letter that came about the balcony, we did find out about putting in the gallery, he was furious. And when he wrote back, he said, I know that our Lord Jesus said, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed, but anyone who sits in that balcony will not see anything.
Right, right. Yes, in the back. Right, the Spanish influence at the top. Yeah, that's a very good question. I'm not sure why he. I think the question was, why was there sort of this like Spanish embellishment right at the cornice at the top? That's a very good question. I'm not sure, you know, why that was added or why that was part of his design. Again, I go back to his training, his furniture. Maybe he just wanted a little flourish. Up there.
I have a quick story about that one too. I was hoping Dodo and Charlie Applewhite was still in the room. Are they here? Oh, there you are. Oh, was it you that told me the story because you were living right across the street that one morning you were awakened very early with a man on top of the church with a sledgehammer pounding the cross off the top of the.
Wow.
No, not you. Someone.
I think you did.
It was you? But that was taking off that Alamo kind of arch
right.
That was added. They pounded it off in that earlier restoration, the one just before Tom.
Right. Oh, one other tidbit about Latrobe, he was the organist at St. John's. I mean, just a Renaissance person. Unbelievable. Yes, Peter.
Just a comment, not a question. You know I'm kind of a construction junkie, watching projects around town.
Right.
So when this project was underway, I would detour and stop and visit. The craftsmen, the Hispanic immigrant craftsmen that were painting the
Mm-hmm.
It was absolutely amazing to watch their reverence as they were working on this structure.
Right.
I mean, I got up close to them. This was their place. I mean, it was amazing to watch craftsmen work on
right. That. We actually interviewed craftsmen for the project and in consult with Baird Smith, who we retained as a preservationist architect for the project. I mean, I think they're the best in the region, and as Peter says, they really took care. I mean, they did it right. And those white lines are to emulate, you know, cut stone. Yes? Amy?
No. Laura, please.
I'm thinking about the conversation of the balcony and following the principles of architecture. One of the monasteries in France, for example, is that if you stand in the very front, you have these perfect acoustics. And someone like Warren, when he's giving a speech, everyone can hear without any audio.
Right.
Assistance. So I'm wondering, was that part of the conversation, the acoustical design, if you put the balcony up there, no one can hear you anymore because the resonance is compromised?
pedestal pulpit then. That was part of that original design. So that would have been higher up as well.
Right. That's a very good point. I mean, again, Latrobe was aware of acoustics and had just been burned at the Capitol. There was a round space, or it was an oval space. Can't remember. Not the Great Hall, but anyway, there was an oval space on the south wing. Acoustically, was really bad. He just finished it, and he came in. They came back and hung red velvet drapes. So he was very aware of acoustics and had issues with acoustics. The size of this space and the general cubage helps in accommodating the acoustics of adding a balcony to this kind of space. But geometry is key to acoustics. It's all about it. Yes.
Tom, once upon a time, there was a gold ceiling in the sanctuary. What's the story behind its arrival and departure?
That's the first I've heard of it, but I'd have to date it to the Victorian period. I'd have to say, 1890 or something, folks were, that was what we were doing in that, It'd be interesting to find out more about that. I mean, that would be in the annuals here. There were really only two books on Latrobe's life, the domestic architecture and a biography in 1955 I've used. So, not many books. Yes, in the back.
That gold ceiling that was there until relatively recently. I was on the vestry at the time, and there was a flurry of excitement in the vestry because we thought it was gold.
Real gold.
And we thought we raised some money for the church.
Right.
It turned out to be wallpaper.
Oh, really? Oh, man. Yeah. Any other comments? Yes, the back.
Above that ceiling, what is above the ceiling in the church? Is it a thing to protect that there's an arch on the outside of what instead of keeping everything? Right?
Yeah, the structure of the roof are heavy wooden trusses, and then the vaulted gypsum or plaster ceiling is hung from that. I mean, it could be similar to this with a hung ceiling below. So the ceiling is sort of independent of the trusses.
And there's a crawl space up there.
Yes.
Can I put Maury Hoven on the spot?
Maury,
you got
yeah,
to
Maury.
Story.
We were, the time came when we went up there and was basically determining how the sprinkler system
worked. Right.
And what we looked at the hatch, we found this person staring back at us. And we found a tenant that was living up there. And he had figured a way how to get into the kitchen and back it up and across. And he had a television up there.
Amazing.
I was more surprised.
Right.
It's a great story.
Yeah. That is amazing. Yes, in the back. Oh, I'm sorry, yes. Okay, he's got a temper, right? He's avid about the profession. So in the construction of the South Wing, he and Thornton had another disagreement. And in front of President Adams, he's standing there, and Thornton is just accusing him of just, derelict, not responsible. And so Latrobe goes and just knocks him out. Right in front of the president. The next day he resigns. He then goes to New Orleans. Previously, he had sent his son to New Orleans to work on the waterworks. And his son dies of yellow fever because of the environment. So Latrobe says, all right, I'll go down and finish John's work. So he goes down to New Orleans, and he dies within 9 months of yellow fever. He was 55. Yeah.
Okay,
it was rough.
Stop right there. Tom, my heart's
Welcome.
Full seeing that, all those pictures. It's really amazing.
My pleasure. Thank you.